source of form. Like, where do architects get these forms from? And so that's a key question in this topic. It also turns out to be one of the key questions in your studio and in architecture generally. What is the source of form? Why this form, not that form? What makes a form worth exploring the possibilities of? And don't expect a clear answer. But one of your challenges as a student and as a professional is identifying forms that are capable of doing what you need them to do. And what you need them to do might be deeply and profoundly personal. It might also have to do with your understanding of what the world needs right now and what the future of the world needs. And so that's one of the really interesting things about the Art Nouveau is I'm going to be going blah, blah, blah a lot. But you'll notice that I can't really get at the key issue that matters for us most as architects, which is has to do with form. Where do these forms come from? How can you judge form as being good form or bad form? Is it ever anything more than just subjective personal taste? Good question. But before we jump into that, you guys got some grades back. You've gotten sketch grades back, you've gotten quiz grades back, exam grades back. The first question you should ask is, what? Who wants to ask a question? It's a burning question. Yes. When will the writing grade come out? I don't know, I'm kind of overwhelmed. That's a lot of those exams are crazy hard to grade. Time consuming, not hard. Working on it. Yes?
When will we get our exam sheets
back? It's in this packet. If you got your packet, the exam is in there. So each question in the exam was worth 2 points. I was generally quite generous. I always have something in mind when I write the exam questions, and I'm always surprised by the responses that some students give. It has nothing to do with what I was thinking you would say. But if it makes sense and it works, that's fine. I'm giving you credit for wherever I can. Now, as the key question in the sketches, the sketches were graded on a scale of 15, right? So 7 points out of 15, I was saying, that's not bad. You have room to improve. You should do better than that. But this is not horrible. It's not an F, right? I was saying that 7 out of 15 is not whatever the mathematical equivalent of 7 out of 15 is. So, 7, minus something, not horrible, do some work, but it's not proportional to the 100% thing. The exams, in contrast, if you got 10, 11, 12, or less on the exam, there is something wrong. You should pay very close attention to what you got wrong that generated a score of 10, 11, 12 on the exam, and you should look into what the right answer is, how come I didn't understand that, and what can I do to make sure that on the next three versions of this exam that I'm gonna get 18, 19, 20, yes.
Well, I haven't completed the exams because of the class
here? Does that sound right? I'm open to discussing. I'm actually meeting with my colleagues who develop this course, and we'll be working out. I'll share them first thing your comment, and we'll be working out what the right thing is. That said, I hear your points. I believe they have merit. It could be that we are making a correction in the course. That might be the outcome, that we're making the course a little bit less about memorization of name states and places, and more about architectural ideas that are closer to the center of what the profession, the world, expect of us as professionals. They expect us to identify ideas and know how to deploy architecture that delivers on the promise of what architecture can do, should do, and must do for society. So you can tell it was kind of this passionate, big, I think we should do a much better job here at preparing for success in the profession. And might be that we need to ease the transition, so it's not just a shock for those of you who did fail the exam, or do much worse than we expected, or did not prepare properly. There's probably something we can do to ease that, because I don't want anyone to get a bad grade, or I don't want anyone to be shocked and surprised by these things. I'm much more interested about using the exam as a tool for teaching. And so, even if we add 5 points to everybody's score, I'm not saying we're going to do that, but even if we do that, I'm happy, right? Because we get to make these exams more about what matters in the course and in this this discipline. So, grade for A's. I want you all to get A's. You should all be getting an A in this course. So, I'm okay with that. If you all get A's, I'll probably get in trouble from department head and the dean and provost. But if you all earn A's, I have to give you A's. And I'll take the hit. But so that means what I'm saying is there's room for me to be generous with the grades on this first exam. But don't expect the exams. The conversation we have today will start the process of determining whether my version of the exam is just a dumb idea and don't do that ever again, or it's the new way to do exams. Either way, we'll try to make it so it's, you don't take the grade yet because we surprised you. Yeah. Good point. You'll notice the sketches are different than last year, too. Yeah. Sorry, and you're welcome. But let's get the grade part, not to be so hard. Yeah.
So people that didn't submit their sketches on Blackboard might still need two forms of, hard copy and on your group, but still kind of zeros.
Some of you have zeros on Blackboard still, is the message I'm getting.
Yeah.
I don't think that goes.
No.
I don't know why they didn't
mention it. You put a note down.
Yeah, that's not a grade thing. I thought I had graded them. I'll get to it. If you submitted it in any form whatsoever, you do not get a zero. That will not stand. Right? But please, having said that, please submit all three versions. Just to make it life better for my colleagues. No matter what my preference is, they want the three versions. Okay? Yes?
So, for this quiz, some people have like that duplicate page or something, and we're offered another
Yes. Maybe we should talk about this after. I don't want to confuse people. Some people had come up, someone had come up three times because we kept getting malfunctioning exams. And, you know, that's got to be hard. So I offered, I think that's what happened. But if I'm wrong, then maybe I owe you all a couple points. Yeah. Can everyone hear?
I don't
know. So it's like being able to choose like 10 out of 12 questions. Being able to choose like what you actually study versus something that you didn't.
Yeah, she had a great suggestion of, hey, what if everybody had a chance to choose their favorite 10 questions out of 12? Wouldn't that be a better exam? And I was thinking yes, but then I graded them all, and it's about a 7-hour process, 7 or 8-hour process. If you're faced with 12 questions, how many of you will answer all 12, just in case? Right? So I'm going to grade the first 10 that you answer, and I'm going to ignore the last two. How's that? Does that work?
That's what they did.
Certainly your favorites.
I'm not going to grade your favorites. I'm not going to count up the ones you scored best on. I'm going to grade the first 10 I encounter. And the last two is not extra credit. It's you do it or not, you get the same outcome. Just because I have too much self-respect and respect for my colleagues to add punishment. This is a very, very strange situation for higher education. It's very rare to have a lecture course with no teaching assistants. It's almost unheard of in higher education. And when that situation does exist, you get multiple choice exam questions because it's impossible. No human would willingly put themselves through the 8 or 9 hours worth of grading. You'll take multiple choice. I knew you. But my colleagues have too much respect for you and the discipline to not have responses. So that's our position. I could give you 12 questions on the exam. I will grade the first 10 that you respond to. So that means you can skip two, right? I'm about to prepare the next exam, so this is good timing. How about that? I will give you 12 questions to choose from. Please answer your favorite 10. If you answer an 11th or a 12th question, I will count the first 10 that I see. And I will ignore the two. I won't read those two that you answer. But you might enjoy these things. People like different things. You might really enjoy sitting there adding questions. But I won't grade those. Does that sound like an okay thing?
Yeah.
Okay. Was there something else? So quiet in here without the HVAC running. Okay, what were we talking about? Art Nouveau? So, people love this topic because the work is so gorgeous. Here's an exam question. There's only two exam questions, and I noticed the same thing that you noticed, that these exam questions that are left over from last year are just different from the exam questions you're getting on the exam. So I changed this one. This one should look familiar. This should be more closer to the format. And you won't get this question, but you will get a question like this. Use the So right now, you might, it wouldn't be crazy to say, look, it's just someone you're building. Brown, nothing special. So your eyes have not yet been opened to everything that's going on in this image. I'm establishing the expectations that we will expect you to say what year this was, what the name of the project is, where it is, and what year, who did it. And be able to point verbally or visually at specific characteristics shown clearly in this image that have some meaning in relationship to the principles of art and love. We expect you to be able to do that, so you should expect me to provide that information for you. Here's another one. Architect Otto Wagner, and that's how you say it. You don't say Wagner, you say Wagner. Of Vienna, Austria. Sometimes we say Viennese. Vienna is a city in Austria. Remember the Ringstrasse? We've seen it before. Architect Otto Wagner of Vienna, Austria is credited with coining the term modern architecture. Identify year, name, and place. You already know the architect. One of his buildings, and use it to show and explain two or more of the most important design principles exemplified in his work. Does that seem more familiar? And you can imagine the multiple variations of this question. So Art Nouveau. This is the slide where we give you kind of a larger picture of the topic. We expect you to be able to assimilate the information that there are certain things that are really important, and we put those in red. So the first thing to know, according to this slide, about the Art Nouveau is that it grows directly out of the arts and crafts. So right now, you should be asking yourself, because you are active critical engagers, you are actively engaging in this material, you should be asking, what is it that is the same as arts and crafts? And what is it that's different than arts and crafts? So one of the things that's the same as the arts and crafts, remember the arts and crafts? They said whatever Beaux-Arts, whatever they taught you in the first few weeks of that history of architecture course, Beaux-Arts, Gothic Revival, Neoclassicism, rational enlightenment approaches, we're going to do everything that they taught in those weeks of the course, as long as it's none of that. We're going to do zero of that. We're going to do the anti-Beaux-Arts, anti-neoclassical, anti-Gothic revival. It's going to be revival nothing. We hate all this hybrid eclectic. Remember the word eclectic? We hate this eclectic classical Gothic revivalism. We're going to do something that has nothing to do with any of those things. That's what Arts and Crafts said. Well, Art Nouveau says, we're with you, brother. That's exactly, we agree with that approach. But at the same time, it's different than Arts and Crafts. What is it that makes Art Nouveau different from Arts and Crafts? Well, remember Arts and Crafts and William Morris. It was all about, in John Ruskin, it was all about craft. The imprint that the craftsman makes, the hand, the making, the act of making, the love of the making has to show in the final outcome. And everything in your home should be useful, beautiful, and beautiful as a result of bearing the imprint of the passion and love and commitment of the craftspeople who made it. The other weird thing about Art Nouveau, and this is something that we're struggling with as a discipline, did Art Nouveau start in one place and then spread to these other places? It might have, but there's also evidence to suggest, no, this is like, it was in the air. It was a spontaneous generation. You know that calculus was invented by Sir Isaac Newton, but it was also invented by that other guy who didn't get credit for it, Leibniz, I think, at the same time, in two different places. So sometimes ideas travel in mystical ways and emerge in multiple places all at once, like agriculture. So here are the different places and names given to those different places. We chose one, Art Nouveau, because we've, as you've noticed in this course, if it's French, we like it. And now back to the original thing I was saying about the in-class exercise. The form metaphors, like what is it? This is the mystical key to making the Art Nouveau the Art Nouveau, is what are the form metaphors of arts and crafts has craftsmanship at the heart and soul of the form? And what is at the core of the Art Nouveau form? It has something to do with these metaphors. Not so clear. You start to get a hint because there's an image over there. So, no red in this caption, so maybe I don't have to memorize any names or dates or places. I'm just going to look at the image. Isn't that interesting how the skin of this mill building is starting to become like a decorated jewelry box? How strange. So this is an early root. It isn't exactly Art Nouveau, but it starts to hint at something going on. Now we're getting more to the heart of it. This is the second time we've seen this image. And it's not necessarily the most important features of this image are not the architecture. It's not a building. It's the graphic arts that are framed, and it's the framings of those graphic arts. We see John Ruskin, one of the heroes of the course, mentioned again, talking about the rejection of classical traditions and the embrace of natural forms. Yes, check, we got that. But it's not a direct, accurate replication of nature. It's a stylized emulation of nature. So there's a design lens, there's an active design component to the production of graphic forms that are shown in this picture. It has something to do with the sudden emergence, right? We talked about the Oklahoma port building, we talked about aesthetic movement, eclecticism being embraced. It's an English eclectic movement that was embraced by Japanese imperialism and translated and used as the vocabulary of Japanese national identity as they marched through East Asia, conquering one society after another. Korea, Taiwan, we saw all this happening. That was all triggered, remember? Commodore Perry landed in Yokohama in 1854. And by 1858, they had an open port trading for the first time in two centuries. For two centuries, it was illegal to talk to a foreigner. It was illegal for a foreigner to show up. And they even put holes in the sides of ships so that they would sink as soon as they left harbor. So for two centuries, Japan was completely isolated from the rest of the world. 1854, the U.S. Commodore Perry comes in and says, "See my guns? You're now trading with the rest of the world." Well, one of the things that happened is suddenly these artistic forms that were developing in complete isolation in Japan for two centuries came out into the world. And one of the impacts of Japan's artistic flourishing in those two centuries was the Art Nouveau. Artists saw what the Japanese had been doing, and they said, there's something going on here. And so the graphic arts took off. The book cover that we're going to look at, I think in the next slide, there's the book cover. So this was a book about Christopher Wren's churches in London. And what's going on here? This is a new graphic attitude that goes beyond the arts and crafts. There's a better picture of that room. The graphic arts, this is an advertisement for salad oil. These things, so graphic arts, this is something that is going to be with us for the next few weeks, especially when Professor Lanzel steps up here, is the impact of the avant-garde artist community on architecture. led by the painters. And so painting in the early 20th century has a profound impact on new innovation and explorations and experimentation in architecture. It's already happening with the Art Nouveau. Victor Horta, that name should be in red because we're going to look at Victor Horta's Hotel Tassel. Given that the exam question was looking at this facade, either this should be in red or we're not going to ask you to identify Victor Horta's Hotel Tassel. Since I'm giving the lecture now and it's not red, then I'm going to say we're not going to ask you to identify Victor Tassel's hotel, Victor Horta's Hotel Tassel. But it is sure as memorable. Look at that railing. This image is one of my favorite images in the whole course, because he was using these floral patterns that end up on the walls and on the floor. He was using these floral patterns that come out of the graphic arts, and he was bringing them in to suddenly, it's not enough to have them jump off the wall and onto the floor, and it's not enough for them to jump off the floor into the railing and into the column. It infects everything. It's almost like a science fiction movie where an alien virus takes over the architecture and suddenly it takes over everything. What is going on here? It's a complete infection of all forms. It's jumping onto the facade. So it's not enough to put these simple railings, the floral infection, and it has to do with continuity. The articulation of the vertical elements, the way they turn corners, the way they connect between the metal and the stone, these rivets that are connecting. It's even the mechanical devices of connection and structure are taking on a decorative character. And it's functional, yes, but it's also part of the decorative strategy. The stonework is spilling over from one element to the other. And the planar facades are taking on curvature. That costs more. And so here we see it in plan. It's moving from painting into architecture. So you see, wherever you see curvature in the plan views, it's pretty subtle in this one. It gets more dramatic elsewhere. But you start to see the introduction of curvilinear forms where previously you never would have seen it. And so here's more. This is the floor pattern at the base of the stair, and here's the wallpaper. And Victor Horta went on to do his most famous project. Now this is in red. This is something that we expect you to know.
This is the Maison de Coupe, which means the people's house. We keep running into these architects and who are clients, and clients are these social movements. The socialist movement at this point in history is growing. People see great positive potential in socialism as a counterpoint to rampant capitalism. And they're using architecture as a vehicle for promoting socialist ideals. How do they do that? In this case, I would say they are creating great luxury and offering them this great luxury to the common people. So this cafe, so you don't have to be a wealthy person to relax in the cafe as you would have in Paris. Now it's in the people's house. Buy something, don't buy something. You are welcome. And by bringing light and air into the upper levels. And so light and air and artistic quality are being offered to the masses, to the common people, regardless of their wealth or status. This is the socialist ideal. Architecture of great beauty is a vehicle for not just reflecting passively that that is a prominent idea. It is at the vanguard. This is at the forefront. If they want to change society, who are you going to call? Exactly. So the architects get called in. Their job is to promote the social ideals. And so they do that by offering great artistic quality, exuberant expression of not just the metal that has to support this rib, but support it as if it grew there. And this is all wrought iron, so there are blacksmiths hammering these forms to make them. So what's the form metaphor? It's plant life. The banisters, wallpaper, floor mosaics are all reflecting the plant life. This is an arts and crafts attitude in the extent that it is functional and it is an aesthetic thing, both at one time. One of the interesting questions that come up all the time with students is this form follows function thing. Is this form following its function? Kinda. There is a, I would say that form and function are coming together, right? This form is functional. It has a structural function to it. But did the form get generated by some pure objective interpretation of form, of function? No. This is not what the robot would have done. This is not what the engineer would have done. There is function and form together in a single element, but it's not a form that was generated by the function in its pure objective form. This is artistic interpretation, inspiration from the vegetative world. There's an integration of material and structure. There's an integration of structure and expression in the single material form. This is the direct use of modern materials to perform the function of holding up that rib, as suggested by Viollet-le-Duc. And this is at the very top, an auditorium with over 1,000 seats. And everything in here is both functional and artistic. The acoustic form of the roof to control reverberations, the structural elements of the trusses. You see, I bet you can tell me whether that's cast iron or wrought iron, right? What is it, cast iron or wrought iron? It's wrought iron because you see these diagonals are in tension. So it must be wrought iron. And so there are functional, artistic mergers going on all over the place. These railings, the shape of the balconies in relationship to each each other, the undulation of the roof, and every opportunity they have, they bring in light and air using the architectural language of the French bourgeoisie of the department stores and the market sheds and the train sheds. They're bringing that level of luxury, light, and air into the people's hall. And you see it also in section and in plan. Every place you can point out to the simultaneity of artistic interpretation and functional performance. It's hard to see here, but these patterns are purely, they're very structural, these are the structures, but they're starting to emulate the kind of structures you would see in a forest canopy. And even some of the shapes of the architecture are starting to emulate the potential of more artistic form, so that anything that deviates from the rectilinear is treated as an opportunity to invoke this form metaphor in plan even. So stair railings, if you haven't figured out a strategy for satisfying the code requirements of your railing, this would be an excellent point to be inspired. The French code at the time was more forgiving. The current international building code says that if you take a 4-inch spear and you can pass it through the railing at any point, then it's not to code. It won't pass because a baby's head, I guess when they're 3 days old, maybe, but a baby's head can fit through that 4-inch gap. So follow those grid lines. Get those 4-inch spheres. Picture a 4-inch sphere and make sure that a 4-inch sphere can't pass through your railing. It's harder than it seems. It's one of the hardest things in stair railing design these days. So the next character in this story is Henri Vandeveld. And he didn't do a lot of architecture per se, he did a lot of interiors. But the thing to remember about Vandeveld is that he is associated with this word, Gesamtkunstwerk. And if you said Gesundheit, you're not far off. So Gesamtkunstwerk is the fancy pants German term for a complete work of art. It was originally applied to the operatic work of composer, opera composer Wagner. He's been mentioned in this course before because his operas were the inspiration of that crazy castle by Ludwig III in Bavaria. But Wagner's operas were considered to be grand Gesamtkunstwerks, as he was composing the music, writing the story, designing the sets, costuming the performers. So every piece of the presentation was an artistic production of a single unified creator of the composer of the opera. That's how Henri Vandeveld approached his productions. And he made this distinction that is useful. He could have used this distinction when we were talking about Victor Horta's work, right? In ornament, is a frank expression of the inner functional forces of an element, and it's a good thing. Ornamentation is a superficial applique on top of that to decorate and pretty things up. That's bad. So Henri Vandeveld made this distinction between ornament and ornamentation. Great exam question. He also envisioned, he was another one of these socialists who said mass production is a good thing because it will bring artistic quality to everyone because it's so much cheaper. One imagines that once you design something like this, you would mass produce it because you would be using molding techniques or craftsman factories, but somehow you would be able to mass produce these things that the first version is an intensely customized aspect that was reserved largely for the extremely wealthy. He designed a house for himself, including all the furnishings in it. And he even designed the gowns that would fit in best with the interior design. So his wife was required. People make fun of Henri van de Velde because he is a quintessential controlling bastard that all of your friends will think you are as a designer, as an architect. Everything has to be just so. And so he is the extreme version of this. And here's the office of de Graaf, a wealthy merchant. And Van de Velde designed the desk, he designed the wallpaper, he designed the artwork, he designed the light fixture, the vase, the teacup set, the gown. And here it is, the sculpture. So most of the designed things in this photograph were all designed by Henri van de Velde. What's that German word? I can't remember already. What is it? Gesundheit? What was the word? No one remembers? Well, you can remember it like this. Werk means work, right? So in German, Werk means work. Kunstwerk means artistic work. So everyone say Kunstwerk. Louder. Kunstwerk. You were saying it up there. Again, Kunstwerk. Okay. Gesamt. Now, this is the hard part. Gesamt. Gesamt. I'm doing too much Dutch. Ask Christina how to say it in German. But let's say it all together. Kunstwerk. Gesamt. Gesamt Kunstwerk. Gesamt Kunstwerk. There, it's not so hard, right? Ask Christina, I can't do this. Okay, so we also did theater. We don't have time. So let's move on to the next guy in red, Hector Guimont. Guimont. So have you ever seen this subway entry? This is his big famous piece, and they've replicated it in other cities because it's so beloved. And so Hector Guimont designed a lot of entryways, and it was his goal was to directly exemplify the ambitions of Viollet-le-Duc. So we've been hearing about this guy Viollet-le-Duc the entire semester. And we know that the Chicago architects were inspired by his words as well. So he's still inspiring people today. But here he is inspiring the work, this work of Art Nouveau, saying that even if the Greeks didn't invent this, it was inevitable. It would have come about anyway. Even if there was no Middle Ages, there is a destiny for form. These forms come up as if on their own power. They emerge from the world. Remember, the world is the number one source of all understanding. He's kind of tuning into the forces of the world, and he's saying these forms are inevitable. They must emerge through the artistic work of artisan architects. And so here he goes, just luscious, lovely, wonderful. This is cast iron. Right, because there are big solid forms. So in general, this work is a combination of cast forms and wrought forms. And the use of light, again, all of the irony his house. So we talk about how things move from the wallpaper into the floor, into the metalwork. And so you see it in the metalwork, you see it in the textiles and the draperies, but then you start to see it in the solid forms of the masonry work. You see it in the undulating facades, the surrounds of the windows. Every time we can work a curve into this stuff, we're going to work a curve into it. Especially in metalwork. So very wild, asymmetrical. Remember, symmetry is what they would do in the Beaux-Arts, in the classical tradition, even much of the Gothic. If it's symmetric, we're not going to do it. If it's Beaux-Arts, we're not going to do it. We're going to freely create. Remember, the Italian version of Art Nouveau is called style liberté, liberty. And so it was a liberated style, free. Now, everyone's favorite Art Nouveau architect is Antoni Gaudí. But he didn't know he was an Art Nouveau architect. He was doing his own thing. And in many cases, he was doing it before any of these French Belgian guys. And so, how does Gaudí fit into the Art Nouveau? Well, it's awkward for us. He didn't study with any of these people. He pretty much stayed in Barcelona, in Spain. Some of you will go there in the next few years. And so, he seems to have discovered it independently. A lot of it comes from a similar vegetable source of form metaphor, but some of it is from animals, zoomorphic. Zoomorphism is what we call animal forms. It's skeletal. Some of the forms are completely fantastical, having to do with his mystical Catholic upbringing. Some of them are more scientific. That does anyone know the story of the structural design of this tower, these towers? Anyone heard this story? No? You do? What is it? Don't you wish we had a picture of it? Okay, we'll work on it. So you can't hear it, so I'll show you. Was it in the lecture?
We had it in tech.
In tech?
Yeah.
And I see in tech you're looking at libraries, and you looked at bibliotheques on Gen Ed.
Mm-hmm.
I agree. As in there, I didn't have nothing to do with it. So this is his crowning achievement. It's not quite finished yet, which is in the tradition of grand cathedrals. They take centuries often to build, as you know. And you see the cranes still under construction. They decided they really want to finish it, so they're really pushing hard. And so it started in 1883. He took over from a different architect. The foundations were already laid according to a very straightforward Gothic Revival cathedral plan, something like the Cologne Cathedral in Germany, which you all know about. But Gaudí was an apprentice for those years. But then in 1883, Gaudí takes over. And as it moves up, you can start to see it pretty traditional right there, right? Those windows look pretty familiar, Gothic Revival-ish. But as you go up, ooh, he's getting kind of creative, a little bit crazy and absolute bonkers and nutty. And so we speculate, was he influenced by his time in North Africa, the Berber tribes of North Africa? Was he influenced by some of their adobe, mud adobe forms? Maybe, who knows? But how do you explain this? It doesn't seem to come directly out of what's happening in Brussels, Belgium. It doesn't seem to be directly coming out of Japanese. I don't know what this is. But here's, so what's going on here? You saw this in tech. Why? When did you take tech?
So we saw it in tech 2.
You saw it in tech 2? They're finding natural parables. Didn't we talk about this in the Gothic Revival? We talked about how when I used to teach Tech 1, you would take sugar cubes and hang them from a strip of tape and trace that shape. And then we'd shave down the sugar cubes so that they would fit together and make that exact same shape. And then you could take away the formwork, and this huge arch of sugar cubes would stand on its own because it's pure compression. The shape of a chain hanging is the exact shape of perfection, of pure compression. So pure tension flips into pure compression. One of the beautiful poetic moments of what we do. So one of architecture's favorite images of all time is this one right here. Antonio Gaudi finding the form of his cathedral by directly translating the natural forces of the structure from tension into compression. He also did a lot of, he was prolific, and he did a lot of residential work. And some of this is some of the most voluptuous architecture you could ever hope to go visit on your honeymoon or study abroad semester. Reason number one to choose the concentration that has study abroad in Jerome, Spain over Berlin, Antonio Gaudi. Which, I don't know which concentration that is. So again, even though he's not writing letters back and forth with his colleagues in France and Belgium, he is still doing the same thing that they are. They are producing form that has never been seen before. It's not Beaux-Arts, it's not eclectic. It is emerging from some mystical place that is difficult to define. This is starting to look like bone structure to me. What do you think? Bones? Plants? Fungus? Waves? Some people have said waves. Just really interesting stuff. And he did a park that is by far his most mystical work. But who's got time for that? We've got to go to Scotland and visit the work of Renee McIntosh. We're going to pass through some of his other things, but the thing to remember is what's in red. Charles Renee McIntosh and his Glasgow School of Art. I was heartbroken. I went there last summer, and it was covered with scaffolding and closed, and so none of these photographs are mine. But when you get to see it someday, after your student loans are paid off, you can see it refurbished. And Stephen Paul built another building right behind it, not nearly as good. But here we are, way out in Scotland, a long ways away from Spain, a long ways away from Brussels and Paris, and the other people we associate with Art Nouveau, but somehow still, he is taking the arts and crafts approach, and he is boosting the artistic element of it. It's becoming much more arts and much less crafts. His form work is much more austere in the larger shape of things. But still, he's taking liberties with the curves and especially with the metalwork. So what is all this going on? What is even the function of this? It does something, I just can't remember what it is. It was all under scaffold. This is the part that we're working. But curvatures and plan and section, making things much more complex and difficult to build than necessary. And yet at the same time, he's anticipating this kind of factory window, industrial window aesthetic that you're going to be seeing in the next few weeks when you get to Bauhaus, etc. But a fantastic exploration, especially in the library, of experiments and furniture. There is a Gesamtkunstwerk thing going on here. Remember that word, Gesamtkunstwerk? And he did a house, but we don't have time. But you see the wallpaper, the furniture, the windows, the draperies, the upholstery of the window seats, right? The tables, the carpet, the lampshade, the moldings, everything, the seats, it's all designed as if a single artist did it, because a single artist did do it, he collaborated with his wife, actually. So he was part of the group before we heard about in the arts and crafts. Less involvement with curvature in the plan, but everywhere else still. So now we get to the final topic, which is what happens in Vienna. You remember Vienna. We talked about Haussmann's transformation of Paris to widen the boulevards and move the troops. We also talked about when the Ottoman Empire stopped ransacking European cities, and there was no longer a need for the defensive wall around Vienna, Austria, which was the next city to be conquered if it were going to be conquered. Things had settled down, technology became such that the walls weren't going to do any good anyway. So they decided to tear down the walls around Vienna and fill in the fields of fire with grids and big Beaux-Arts buildings and wide boulevards, learning all the lessons from Haussmann's transformation of Paris. Well, these guys, the Jugendstil, which is German for youth style, they said, enough is enough with all this grand Beaux-Arts bourgeoisie transformation of Vienna. They didn't like the Ringstrasse. They wanted to bring an artistic expression into Vienna. Vienna is going through a radical transformation at this moment. Sigmund Freud is emerging. Gustav Klimt, we're going to glimpse some of his paintings. And the architects and the arts in general were exploding in revolutionary new explorations and experimentations. And the architects wanted to be part of that movement. So they seceded from the other architectural practices of Europe, the prior architectural practices of Europe, and they called themselves the secession, because they were seceding from the stuff we talked about, the Beaux-Arts, the eclecticism, the different revivals. We're seceding from all that. We're going to start from scratch, and we're going to create a modern architecture. Otto Wagner, in fact, was the first person to coin the term modern architecture in his 1895 book, which he called Modern Architecture. And the thing that was modern about modern architecture is that it reflected the values and practices of modern life. It was the Enlightenment finally moving beyond the neoclassicism of the earlier period, the Gothic Revival, the Beaux-Arts. We're moving past all of that. Remember, the whole course we've done so far started with the Enlightenment, where it's no longer about God and church and king and queen. This is scientific, rational. Every human being through education has access to the truth. They can verify, confirm, explore the truth on their own. We are an enlightened society. But for 100 years, we went through all of these stylistic explorations, and these guys are saying, this is not good enough. It is not modern enough. It's too beholden to the past. We are breaking the shackles from the past. We are starting over something brand new and fresh, which is the first emergence of that idea as arts and crafts. And now we see it reinforced and amplified in the Art Nouveau. And so you see things that look to us like rustication, but these are thin materials applied to a structural base. How can you tell? Because you can see the connections. The These are not decorative dots. These are structural connections. These are mechanical connectors to take a thin sheet material and attach it to a structural armature. And they are expressing that function and using it as an artistic embellishment. This is where Otto Wagner started out, doing what looks almost like a replica of what building? This is a villa, but it looks like it's a carbon copy run through a shrink machine of what building that we have studied. Done by a journal. Who is it? Altus Museum. By who? Who did the Altus Museum?
Schinkel.
Points there. And where is it? Where's the Altus Museum?
Berlin.
Yeah, it looks like an Altus Museum, right? This is how Otto Wagner started out. So one of the lessons you can learn from this is, well, I was a brilliant student at Wentworth. I was the favorite one of all my professors. They thought I was going to be the superstar out of the program because I was so into it. But then I had to do the internship thing, and I worked for some architects, and they tend to be very conservative. So please forgive these early projects in my portfolio. They look like everybody else's portfolio. But later in my career, I started to pick up on some of the things I was learning about in history class when I was a sophomore, and started to explore more thoroughly when I was in the studio, and it kind of took on a life of its own. So that's the story of Otto Wagner. You guys are going to have to apprenticeship and work for other architects, but you shouldn't let go of the spark that's inside you that needs to come out. Right? So this was inside Otto Wagner, and it needed to come out. These other people were doing it in Belgium, and Paris, and Spain, and Scotland. So why wouldn't I? So notice we're here at 1898. It's really back to the jewelry box, decorative arts being expressed on the outside skin. Not that satisfying yet, but hold on, it gets better. This, you will see because it's in red, is the big project of the lecture. In 1905, he creates the icon of the Vienna Secession movement in the Postal Savings Bank. In Vienna. And so let's look at what the big deal is, right? So what's the big deal? So here's the big deal. It's not exactly Art Nouveau, right? Is this floral and vegetal? Not really, and not explicitly. It's not a direct outgrowth of what we saw happening in Belgium and France. It's not, just like Gaudí's work in Spain is not the same, but there's a similarity, there's a similar attitude towards exploring form metaphors, and that's why we teach these topics in the same lecture. Is Vienna Secession an Art Nouveau movement?
No.
Really. But we put it in the same lecture because they're tuned into some bigger forces and bigger questions and bigger issues that seem to emerge from a similar place, a radical departure from everything that came before, and this courage to explore forms that have not been seen before. There's no precedent for these forms. They're kind of, these forms are newish. There's a base and a capital and a shaft, but we've never seen anything like this. The proportions, the articulation, these tapered rib is more than the minimum necessary, because they are exploiting the expressive potential of the metalwork whenever they can. It's hard to convince the clients to do that because things cost. But you propose it anyway. So here we are. What does this remind you of? There's something going on here that we've seen before. What is this kind of like? Crystal Palace. Crystal Palace idea. They're letting in the light, but it's through this milky glass. They are trying to dematerialize. Have you used that word before? Glass wall, dematerialization of surfaces. That's what we used to do, like in Hagia Sophia, in the Byzantine churches. We had these massive structures on the interiors of Romanesque churches and early Christian churches. And then as we move along in history, we try to make it feel lighter by putting tessellated mosaics that reflect the light, and make it feel lighter. Well, here, it really is lighter. And so they were able to use the iron and glass trickery of the Crystal Palace. This time, you can't even see the structure because they've made the glass translucent. In order to make it seem very light. So other things, so I'm gesturing with my hand, I should be using my laser, right? There's a denial of structural capacity here. It seems impossibly light because you don't see how it's being held up. A very minimum of being here. It continues on in these apse-like spaces. And then look at the floor. It goes out again. In the floor, they're using glass block over the vaults below. So if you're going to rob this bank, going through the glass floor, so that's. But they're even denying the solidity of the floor they're standing on by making it a source of light as well. So they're very committed to the lightness of the structure. And every detail is exploited as an opportunity to demonstrate or express artistic ambitions. So the ventilator, the heating system, the lighting system, the light fixtures, all the utilitarian elements of the Postal Savings Bank are being exploited as opportunities for artistic expression. Again, the furniture is designed, the rivets that hold the cladding onto the structure are celebrated and expressed in everything. And so he did some other stuff that's not in red. But you see, so the thing to look at here, so we look at this main structure, this main iconic work by Otto Wagner of the Vienna Secession. But we're looking at some of the other projects surrounding it to confirm or verify what the issues really are. So here's a residential project. There's a feeling of thinness to the materiality. You can tell by the corners. If you want to express a thickness to the materiality, you do something like this. You show the thickness of the thing, even if it's a lie, we all know it's a lie. If you want to express thinness, you expose an edge at the corner, and he is radically comfortable with expressing thinness. Let's see where else that happens. Let's see, there's probably close-ups. But this is, how thick are these materials? So there's a comfort level with expressing thinness, which is a very radical and modern expression. So here's more Vienna Secession. Wagner was not alone. Others, Ulbricht. This was a building designed for secession art exhibition. Again, wrong button. So every service is an opportunity for celebration or for leaving it cleanly blank. The key feature of this is this very lightweight gold foliage that creates a sphere at the top that was lit up. So you can see right through the sphere. Versacrum is the spring that is at the, let's see, they published a journal and it was called Versacrum. And it was, so the architecture itself is a vehicle for promoting the ideals of the Vienna Secession, but it's also promoted through the publication of a regular journal. That still happens. Art Daily is still doing that. So Joseph Hoffman, another one, he did get influence from Macintosh, and the rest I'm saying is just not that crucial. Just look at what Hoffman does. He's starting to get extremely stark in the work that he produces, with greater attention to interiors and furniture, but again, the total work of art, the design comes first. The architects are designing the architecture, the interiors, the wallpaper, the flooring, the furniture, every opportunity for adding artistic expression and function at the same time through even the infrastructure of the heating system, the lighting systems, the cutlery. And this is going to come up again and again. It's going to come up on Thursday when we talk about Frank Lloyd Wright. It's going to come up in the Bauhaus because they were not just architects. They were visual artists. They were graphic artists. They were industrial designers. They were producing cutlery. So in the weeks to come, this is kind of a formula for propagating and putting out there a vision for transforming the world. You do everything. You don't just do the architecture. You do the whole work of art, the Gesamtkunstwerk. So Hoffman does the Palais Stoffel, a super rich industrialist, wants to create a new home. He wants it to be palatial, and he wants it to be experienced as an exhibition hall. And so that's what goes into this house as exhibition hall. And so there are certain elements of symmetry, but all is thrown off, which is what we talked about with the arts and crafts. And this opulent celebration of interiors. Do you know who that artist is? I mentioned him earlier. Everybody's favorite Viennese painter is who? He painted The Kiss. This is his most famous painting. It's shining and gold. I should show it. Do I have it? That's kind of it. Well, that is it. That is The Kiss. He did so many like this. He would first paint them, first painted it, the two lovers are completely stark naked, and then he clothes them in these richly embroidered tapestries of robes. But somehow we're supposed to get the nakedness beneath all of that tapestry work. But this is the mosaic, the artwork that's on the wall of the dining room of the Palais Stoffel. And again, designing everything down to the tea set. So, Vienna Secession is the final hardware. We could go It's not about artistic rendering of everything. It's about cladding. He wrote a polemical piece about cladding. He said it's all about the material, the richness of the material that you apply to the walls, not the artistic rendering of it. He also said that anyone who has a tattoo is either a cannibal or a criminal, and is either going to end up in jail or die before they get caught. He was so insanely racist that I don't even like talking about this. But here's the thing that we expect you to know. So this might be on the test. I don't know if I'm going to put it on the test. I don't like this guy. I don't like the idea. But this is going to be on the test. When you talk to your colleagues, the test of your colleagues, the test of your clients, they're going to expect you to know the article that he wrote called Ornament as Crime. That's the one where he famously says tattoos are for degenerates and criminals and cannibals, and just as you should not tattoo human bodies, you should not ornament your architecture. Should be plain Jane White star print. One other thing he does, and this is actually something that is useful. If you look at the section, one more point. Is if you look at the section, you have, if you look at one side, you see the expected stacking up of one space, two space, three space. But over here, you're going up a half level, and then this the same height of the second floor, you're having two floors. This is called, the German word is the Raumplan, which is the spatial plan. And what it means is these volumes of space are complexly intersecting. It's a complex intersection of three-dimensional volumes of space. That's the other thing. So tattoos are bad on people and architecture, and clad your walls with rich marbles that don't decorate them, and Raumplan, complex intersection interweaving of spatial volumes. Okay?